Now, this two-part dramatisation of the Stardust tragedy primarily depicts the experience of just one of the 44 families bereaved as a result of the fire, which also left 200 people injured. The programme contains scenes which some viewers may find distressing.
I'm going to have to put that in here. Put that. Look. Still there. I'll put it perfect.
All right. Okay. My smock.
Pair of messes. Martina!
Do you reckon she got the card? She better have.
She's gonna go ballistic.
It's only a bit of crack. Don't forget to ask Dad.
Why me?
You're the oldest. You better not be using my lippy in there.
All yours. Dad?
The answer is no.
You don't even know what she's going to ask.
We're not getting the phone.
Why not?
That's why. Wait a minute. What's this? I wonder who it's for. Oh, no.
Where's mine?
Oh, it's in the next post.
Wonder who that's from.
David's parents have a phone.
That's what I'm afraid of. I can just see the pair of you yakking away for hours. All lovey-dovey.
Everyone has one these days.
What's this? A full-on assault?
What if we were to pay for it, Dad?
I'll think about it, okay?
That means no, then.
I said I'd think about it. Thanks, love. Make sure that young fella doesn't spend all day in the ladder. Yeah?
I told you not to crowd him.
So, are you going to lend us me, aren't you?
No.
Give her a lend of your top.
Why should I?
She's your sister, that's why.
I gave you a lend of me lippy.
No, you didn't. Sisters are supposed to share.
I'll think about it.
Hiya.
Hi, David.
Young love.
Yeah.
Have you seen Robert?
Work with a Mary.
And? Everything's fine, okay?
Early for that.
Jealous, Jimmy?
I'll have to move on. Even Robert, from what I hear. You do not know?
Yeah, of course did.
Anything for me?
I just want to pay the lecky.
Your ma, your face like a smacked arse on her.
She wants me to babysit with her tonight.
Tonight? It's Friday, Jimmy. Soup's in the freezer and everything.
That's why the face.
Jimmy, Liam, stop yapping like a pair of L1s and get the cabinets filled up. Oh, by the way, I'll be letting you know this evening which one you're on keeping on.
Well, I thought we had till the end of the month.
Yeah, well, you see what Todd did. Be back in a minute.
Joy or shy. It's me foot.
Might be me.
Ah, you're looking well today, Mrs. Duffy, so what can I get you? Would you like a bit of white pudding? Or would you prefer the black, lad? Maybe a bit of both?
You don't have the measurements, we can't give you a price. Hiya, Robert. Give us a look. What, you think I'm going to tear it up or something? You should have told me.
Yeah, I know.
What's her name?
Paula.
Didn't take him long.
No.
Model for his wall with that card. Still pointing, are
you? Fuck off, Curtis.
Must get myself one.
Take more than a card with you. You need to buy the whole shop.
Don't know about that.
I'm not interested, Curtis.
Your sister is, boy.
Came this morning. Says he's going to reveal himself tonight.
That's nice.
I'm sure it's him.
Who?
Your man. From the vegetable department in Super Quinn. Even cut off a lock of his hair, look.
Don't build your hopes up.
Put deposit on them shoes and all.
For your man?
No. He's gonna buy them in anyway.
Your ma's gonna go ballistic.
Well, you're only young once. Sister Mary.
I told you that in confidence.
Yeah, we're not going to pull much if you're dressed in a habit.
I'm only thinking about it.
That's why you're meeting Carrots, is it? Put you off men for the rest of your life.
I couldn't say no.
Well, you better learn quick. They don't call him the octopus for nothing. See you later.
See you later.
But if I'm the first to rise above, please give him a message, a sign of love. Written in marker, pen, sorry. Sealed with a kiss. His name is David. The guy that I miss.
Bit morbid, isn't it?
It's better than roses are red.
Violets are blue.
Drop your cats and give us a goo.
I bumped into Martina this morning.
Glad you two are talking again.
Yeah, it's Freddie put up a better dump of them.
It was mutual.
Rebound job. Here, on the house.
You get yourself into trouble.
Could be a little shite.
I'll fix up with you Monday.
Oh, Mrs. Keegan in the book, Carol.
That's a pound of stew and beef.
I saw that.
Well, goodwill, Mr. Kelly. Albert, thought you'd be at home pouring yourself into your soup for tonight.
No, JB needed it. He's gone for a job interview with your man Butterly.
To work in the Stardust?
A star man out in Wonder Warehouses out the back. Here's a pound of sausages.
Here's for Errol, Eddie.
What?
Probably needs a bit of extra padding for the final tonight.
I've had a breakfast in the morning.
After sticking them down his jocks all night?
Ah, that's disgusting.
We'll still eat them, though.
You're fucking right. You stick them in the book for us, Kel.
Oh. Hey, Albert. Say hello to Errol for us, will you?
Yeah, just over there. Mr. Butterly.
Oh, that's me, yeah?
Jimmy Buckley. I'm here for the star man's job.
Oh, that's right, yeah. So, I'll talk to you then. Well, what do you think of the place?
Yeah. Looks great.
Used to be a jam factory.
Yeah, I remember. You could smell the fruit for miles.
You live around here?
Bonnybrook.
You ever worked long?
6 months. Place closed down. We just had a new baby.
Hard times we're living in. Still, Charlie's the man to get us out of it, what?
Hope so.
Job's yours.
Thank you, Mr. Butterly. Thank you.
No problem. You come in Monday and I'll show you the ropes.
I'll see you Monday. Thanks.
So, he's going out tonight?
Yeah, I'm going out.
See you later.
See you.
Hey, David.
How are you, girls?
Hey. Yeah. Happy Valentine's.
Happy Valentine's. It's gorgeous. Thanks.
What's up?
To work a late shift.
Double time.
I'm supposed to be going to the Stardust.
So say no.
Shift ain't going on tonight, it'll be something else. Disco championships. It's gonna be wall to wall. They'll be begging for it.
It'll be delivered first thing tomorrow morning.
You're a great girl.
Thank you very much, Mary.
Thanks very much.
Thought they'd never leave. Let's go.
I have to turn off the lights.
Oh, come on, the shop will be shut and I need them shoes for tonight.
Tell Mary I'll meet her on site.
Tired arse.
See you tonight then.
Oh, actually, I'm not going. Huh? Yeah, Ma's gone out. She needs someone to babysit.
Well, once it's not because of me and Paula.
Don't fat yourself.
Why'd you do that? What? Stick it in the freezer?
Cut your finger off that crease, you would. If you don't look slick, you're just a geek.
Where is he?
5 past, wait, you see.
Now, Carol. Jimmy.
Looks like the wedding's off.
Lads. I'm sorry, Liam. Don't think Butcher and Joe 40.
Fair enough. You're not a bollocks to work for anyway.
Up in court, really?
Job interview.
Oh, yeah, how'd it go?
Didn't.
Once they see the north side and your address, that's it, man.
Tell me about it. Sure, I miss me scratching and all over.
Roll on tonight. A pack of the crisps and a pint of my weddy, please. Shit.
What?
Get in.
Here's your wages, Mum.
Thanks, love.
What's that about?
The usual. You're giving me too much, love.
Overtime from last week.
Overtime's your own. You okay?
Not gone.
What?
Stardust, I'm not gone.
What happened?
Nothing.
Something must have happened if you're not going tonight.
You're not going?
Robert's got a new girlfriend.
Who's Robert?
The ex.
But you only went out with him for a week. Thought you weren't mad about him anyway.
I'm not.
So what's your problem?
He's bringing her tonight.
But you don't fancy him.
That's not the point.
Am I missing something here?
You have to go.
Why?
Because I'm not facing Mary Kay on my own when she finds out about that card.
What card?
Nothing.
Look, there's plenty more fish.
Don't, ma'am.
She's right, though.
What, like carrots, you mean?
Who's carrots?
All right, Dad.
Oh, yeah?
Any chance of feeding the owl, Philip?
Now hold your horses. Give me 5 minutes, all right?
Where's me suit?
Hanging on your door.
Thanks for the grub, Mrs. Fitz.
Sorry about your job, Liam.
Well, Ma's gonna go ape. Worry about it in the morning. Thanks, Ma.
Welcome.
What do you think?
What?
Me moustache.
Where?
On me hole. Where do you think?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think I could see something all right.
Cool, what?
Looks like a bit of bone fluff to me.
You sure you're all right about me getting the job?
Yeah. I always hate the smell of meat anyway. Thank fuck it's Friday.
Carrots, God, Mary.
He asked me, what was I supposed to say?
No.
I'm sure he's not that bad, love.
He is mad. Tell her, Antoinette.
He asked me up to dance and his tongue was halfway down my neck before he knew it.
Followed by his chewing gum.
That is disgusting.
That's carrots.
Hope you like juicy fruit.
Aw. Oh.
Lorraine, give us a hand, maybe. Where'd you get that?
Dava.
That is gorgeous, love.
Thanks.
Now.
Here you go.
Thought you didn't want me to have it.
I changed my mind, didn't I?
I'll never be ready in time anyway.
Oh, yes, you will.
Come on. You're going. Where's the foundation?
Go, girl.
Get out!
I'm only looking for the hairspray.
Hairspray,
girl. Actually, I think
you
do.
You tired?
All right. You?
I'm not the one going back to work.
It's going to be packed tonight.
Fancy going yourself?
You'd choke me. Should hear the way the young fellas talk at work.
Not the girls know how to look after themselves.
Doesn't stop me worrying.
I know.
All right, son?
Fine.
How are you for money?
Okay.
Here. Look after those sisters of yours.
I will.
Let me get the camera. Okay.
I'll drop you down.
No!
See us down there, yeah? Errol, good luck. No need to look, bro, eh?
Cocky little bastard, isn't he?
Albert.
I'm sorry, Mr. B.
Oh, she's very warm, JB.
She'll be fine. Go on, I didn't come all the way over here now not to babysit. Come on off out the Perry. Enjoy yourself. Celebrate your husband's new job. All right?
Mom, Friday's go cold.
She'll be grand. Bye, Dad.
Thanks for the blouse. Looks better on me, though. Glad you came out.
Yeah.
See you later.
See you.
Love the shoes.
Woo.
Mary, did tell you about me Valentine's cards?
Yeah. Fingers crossed he's there tonight.
Didn't actually say he would be, did he?
No. Why else would he send the card? Come on, don't want to be last in the queue.
Padraig is at the top of his game.
I'm a fit guy. I work out every day.
But he needs to reduce his cholesterol level, so he's taking the Flora Proactive Challenge.
And I really like a challenge.
Flora Proactive is enriched with plant sterols, which are clinically proven to actively remove cholesterol.
My handicap can't get any lower, but my cholesterol can.
Flora Proactive actively removes cholesterol.
On DVD at last. Glorious. Stunning. Unmissable. And enchanting.
May I have the next dance, Miss Elizabeth?
From the makers of Bridget Jones's Diary and Love Actually, Pride and Prejudice is a triumph. Relive this classic love story on DVD.
Cinema.
Television.
Haute cuisine.
A sandwich.
Jules Verne, Jean-Paul Sartre, Baudelaire.
Shakespeare.
The new Clio, twice the va-va-voom.
The most romantic city in the world.
Let's see.
Nuala, I finally met the woman of my dreams and she wouldn't touch me with a barge pole. Would you do me the honour of being second best?
Interested in 3.2% interest on savings from the world's safest private bank? Click on rabodirect.ie.
Oh, Pat, you're such a squirt. And with those ears, I hate to think what our children would look like. But I'm desperate, so the answer is yes. Oh.
Rabodirect, the straight-talking online bank.
It's hard finding time for the things you love. When I do, I like to make the most of it. I don't like letting myself or the team down. So it's fair to say that I don't have time for headaches. That's why I choose Panadol Actifast. I find it can get to work up to twice as fast as standard paracetamol tablets you swallow. Panadol Actifast. Twice as fast. It's my choice.
In Paris. Free inside Tuesday's special Valentine's Day Irish Independent. You'll find a great CD featuring a unique collection of your favourite Celtic love songs performed by all your favourite artists. So celebrate your Irishness on Valentine's Day with this unique Celtic love CD. Free inside Tuesday's Irish Independent, Ireland's most loved daily newspaper.
Why settle for less when you dream of more? Like superfast broadband, 30 digital channels, free anytime local and national calls, all for the introductory offer of just €34 per month. Call 1890 53 53 53 or visit magnet.ie to get more.
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 Magnet Entertainment. Always settle for more.
Feeling bloated and uncomfortable? Why not leap into action and ask your pharmacist about Motilium and get your stomach back to work?
From the world of Jumanji, drop in and hang on.
We go home when we're finished.
You can't buy a ride like that.
Sephora, a space adventure.
Do you dream in chocolate? Then discover Lindor, crafted with passion by Lindt's master chocolatiers. When you break its shell, Lindor's lusciously smooth center starts to melt, and so will you. Lindor from Lindt.
Artane forgot her belt.
I wish I was gone.
You will, love.
Mint? Let's go.
Yeah, good luck tonight, all right, so cheers. Yeah. How are you doing, lads? All right, yeah, good. Yeah. Sorry to keep you waiting.
How are you, Mr. Bully?
Ah, there you are. You should have told me you were coming. Is this your wife?
Yep, it's Christine. Me brother Albert.
All right, well, go on inside. You're all right. They're in the house. Have a few meals. What?
I'll see you Monday.
Okay, no problem. I'll see you.
Who just walked in?
You're right then, Mary.
Where
check the toilet and have to buy egg and chips like this. Judging by last night's evening papers, by the way, I bet there'll be a lot more.
What are you doing home, love?
Wouldn't let me in. Girl in front of me looked about 10.
Ah, never mind, love.
All my mates are there. It's my only night out, man.
Now, so I was thinking about getting out. Now, moving on.
Out where?
States.
Fuck off.
I'm serious. She's looking for me here.
You need a green card and all that shite.
How you doing, you're Swiss?
Work illegal, like?
Yeah, why not?
What about us?
I'm not joined at the fucking hip, Jimmy.
But come with me. I don't know. Why not?
Oh, yeah, that's right. You have a job.
What are you waiting for?
The queue's a mile long.
Jesus.
Back on.
Keep sketch.
Sketch!
I got you.
Are you bastards? I'm about to piss all over myself.
Sometimes I feel I've got to run away. I've got to get away from the pain you drive into the heart of me. The love we share seems to go nowhere. And I've lost my light. For I toss and turn, I can't sleep at night.
Maybe we're all better off in the habit.
Friends.
Friends.
That's all right.
Robert. A bit scary looking, isn't she? I'm really You won't be able to use language like that in the convent. I'm only thinking about it. Right, who's for a drink?
Go on.
Let's clear the floor for our next competitor in the case of Disco Champions.
Yeah, well, I need a few more drinks in me before the rhythm gets going.
Look forward to that.
Yeah?
Yeah?
You're having a hope. Thanks. The brothers are watching her like a hawk.
She's out of your league anyway.
Is that right?
Yeah, well, you have to know your limitations, you know?
Before coming over. Scared of being refused? That's my problem. I never can. No! That's limits even for me.
Just wondering if you want to dance.
Sure.
I'm just
doors, will you?
Jeez, again. Slow set me on, boy, now. First mooch of the night. I suppose you didn't have slow sets in your day.
No, we could dance.
Yeah, right.
I'm telling you, the jiving used to go on down the ballerina.
The what?
Ballerina ballroom.
Oh, yeah, my granddad told me about that place, all right.
Man.
What? Sorry, love, was I snoring?
Go to bed, man.
No. I want to wait up for the girls. Where's Johnny?
At the back, sulking. Dad.
Good girl. Isn't she lovely and clean? And the other ear.
Disco scene are, wait for it,
I'm gonna stop making you a prick,
Errol Buckley and Paul McDonald.
Thank you.
Handbag's been stolen, I'd like to report it. Yeah. Yeah, it's been tonight.
We have a slight problem. Let's all just take it nice.
Brigade sirens. It seems that a lot of people are being brought to a number of hospitals in different parts of the city, not just by ambulance. I'll repeat that. There are reports of a fire at the Stardust Nightclub in Artane.
Jesus! Martha, wake up. Wake up.
What? What is it?
Where did Jimmy go with Liam tonight?
Stardust, where they always go.
You better get up.
What?
Grab your coat. Come on!
doing home?
They're not here, are they? You're supposed to be with them.
John, what's wrong?
Find them.
Oh, no, Jesus, no.
When did you last see them?
What?
You were there. You must have seen them going in. But did you see them going in or didn't you?
Come on, John, we'll find them. We'll find them.
For a good night's sleep, try counting all the nights available in the massive room sale now on at Travelodge Ireland. 10,000 nights, just €40 per room per night. Book now at travelodge.ie. Travelodge.
Still getting dandruff? T-Gel anti-dandruff shampoo from Neutrogena helps to eliminate dandruff starting after just one use. For effective dandruff treatment, T-Gel anti-dandruff shampoo from Neutrogena.
These are not just roses. These are long-lasting velvet petal Grand Prix roses. This is not just champagne. This is exclusive Special Reserve Oudinot Rosé champagne. This is not just Valentine's Day. This is M&S Valentine's Day.
His was the name on every girl's lips.
Casanova.
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 Now the most infamous man in Europe.
You are charged with debauchery with a novice.
Oh, she's hardly a novice.
Is about to meet his match.
I'm in love with you, Francesca.
Heath Ledger, Sienna Miller.
Haven't I?
Casanova.
Here lies Mr. Average, who didn't want to rock the boat.
Who just kept going, like Sisyphus pushing the stone.
He left passion to the lovers and poets, because he always liked, never loved.
Yet in his dreams, he's Valentino.
Spartacus,
the greatest. In his dreams, Fay Wray is his.
Here lies Mr. Anything But Average.
Because today he said, please, sir, can I have
more?
More.
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 Broadband, digital TV, telephone. Magnet Entertainment. Always settle for more.
A certain
this
smile
is the very best of Johnny Mathis.
I get misty.
22 just classic tracks from a legendary artist.
When a child is born, until the 12th of never,
cause I'm stone in love with you.
The very best of Johnny Mathis.
Much too little to
CD out now.
Again with you.
Welcome to Carpet Right.
And right now there's 50% off hundreds of carpets.
I love it because the prices are always lower.
Guaranteed.
Only at Carpet Right.
From Extravision, treat someone this Valentine's to the perfect gift. Pride and Prejudice, starring Keira Knightley.
You were the last man in the world I could ever marry.
And Elizabethtown, love brings Drew back from the verge of suicide, starring Orlando Bloom.
This is your life. Let's do something interesting with it.
And Bewitched, starring Nicole Kidman. After years of searching for the perfect leading lady, he's found her, as if by magic.
He's idiotic, and yet I find him completely charming.
Available to rent or buy now at Extravision.
Mr. and Mrs. Keegan, would you follow me, please? She's been given the last rites.
So who do you think is responsible?
Too upset to talk.
Did you have any children in the fire?
I'm sorry.
Had you got children in the fire?
Yeah.
How are they doing?
We found Antoinette. Mary and Martin are still missing.
So where to now?
Please tell us something, will you?
Hey, where are you going?
We were told to come here.
Yeah, we were all told to come here, man.
The door's open.
Come on, love.
You need to see our wedding band.
Why?
You need to see the serial number on it.
What?
To save him, I just the one they have. Please, Christine. Please.
Better you remember them the way they were. Both of them?
No, Jesus, no. Don't say that! Don't you say that! Mary! Mary! I want to see my heart! Please, please! Let me see my heart! I want to see my heart!
It's only now becoming clear. Already it has been described as the worst disaster in the history of the state. Within 15 minutes of the first sighting of the fire, the entire Stardust complex was completely gutted. The Taoiseach has cancelled the Fianna Fáil Ardéis in the RDS, and an impromptu cabinet meeting is now taking place.
This is my native parish, and I know most very, very large number of the families concerned.
It's a terrible holocaust. And it makes one wonder how careful we've been in terms of inspection premises of this kind.
The government has announced Tuesday, the 17th of February, as a national day of mourning, with the current death toll standing at 44 and set to rise. Grief and shock has turned into anger, with victims' families and survivors asking two questions. How did the fire start, and why were so many young lives lost?
You're saying categorically all the exit doors were open?
Categorically all the exit doors were open.
I see.
Everything will come out. When this inquiry, that's what the inquiry is for. And the truth will come out. That's all I'm interested in, is the truth.
We will move in the doll probably on Wednesday to establish a tribunal under the 1921 Act.
Letters of sympathy have poured in from across the globe.
Pope John Paul II, who only 2 years ago expressed his love for the young people of Ireland, sent a message describing how deeply saddened he was by the news of the deaths and suffering of so many young people.
When did you first notice fire in the building?
Well, between 1:15 and 1:30 this morning. We were all up dancing. We looked around when I left. The whole, just one of the bouncers was at the lifted up a screen. It was a big blaze. And once you'd done that, the place just went up.
What sort of a screen?
It was cloth.
I managed to make it to the main door where there's about 100 people in there with me. And I was pushed back and therefore my whole body had fell into the
Come on.
Into fire.
Let's get you upstairs.
Which was coming in and nobody could breathe for about 3 minutes. I don't know how many of us lost. Honestly, I don't.
No.
What ages are they?
He's 19, glad here in the hospital, and my other son is 24. He has 2 kids.
This is a normal lung. And this is your son's. The left lung shows similar deterioration. The lining membrane has severe scarring from the excessive inhalation of carbon monoxide and other toxins.
So what are you saying?
The prognosis is not good.
Well, what do you mean?
We're doing all that we can.
All right, man.
Save your strength, love. The doors were locked, ma'am. I couldn't get out.
Mary, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Mary, Father, Son, Holy Ghost.
You see? I'm sorry.
Is it true?
Get out of here, you pious little prick!
Is it true? Please, please tell me it is true.
I'm so sorry.
Them today, love.
No! No, please!
doctors advise us not to.
No! No!
Justice Keane.
What is it? They've renewed the bastard's license.
But the tribunal isn't even over yet. Are they taking that piss?
Do any good, John.
Coming.
The Department of the Environment bear a share of the responsibility for the scale of the disaster in three areas. Their failure to make building regulations under the Planning Act, their failure to respond to the crisis of morale and efficiency in the Dublin Fire Brigade, although warned of its seriousness by the then city manager in 1978, and their failure to ensure that there were adequate training facilities for firemen and fire officers. The Fire Prevention Department was grossly understaffed at the time of the Stardust applications for planning permission. This staff did not have the specialist qualifications required for the proper assessment of an application such as this. The fact that there was no inspection whatever of this building by any member of the fire brigade, either in the Fire Prevention Department or Firefighting Service, from the day it opened until the fire, was one of the most disquieting facts to emerge at the inquiry. When the building was open to the public, the owners were under a high degree of responsibility to ensure that the premises were properly and efficiently marked so as to ensure fire safety. This they manifestly failed to do. Mr. Eamon Butterley bears a special responsibility for the practice of keeping emergency exits secured with chains and padlocks, a recklessly dangerous practice. Nevertheless, it is the view of this tribunal that the origin of the fire was in all probability arson.
Probable arson. What sort of answer is that?
Bastard didn't even have the decency to turn up.
Mr. Butterley, have you any comment to make on the outcome of the tribunal?
Well, we have been vindicated. I see no reason why it shouldn't be business as usual.
Is it true your intention is to claim against Dublin Corporation for malicious damages?
Thank you.
I have to get out.
Are you all right, love?
Just a little bit of air. Right. I'd like to thank you all for coming. Didn't expect such a big turnout. I suppose we better get down to business. You all know me and Jim, and you all recognise Mr. Hanahoe.
F.O.'s Army. You're the Dubs.
He's agreed to be our solicitor.
And what gives you the right to represent us, what?
Well, I'm not trying.
What is it? You organising anything?
It's Flash Harry, what? And his bleeding dancing queen of a brother there.
Then I'll just fuck off.
Don't tell me to fuck off. We'll get over there and thump the head out of you.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Come on then, you're shy, mate.
I'll reorganise your bleeding face for you.
That's enough!
So.
Please! If we don't stick together, we're never going to get anywhere.
With the help of our solicitor, we examined the 600-page tribunal report.
Black smoke started falling.
310 witnesses were heard over 7 months, including Eamon Butterley, the owner of the Stardust. The report said that the Stardust did not comply with 12 public resort bylaws, 12 fire protection standards, and 6 draft building regulations. The report states that there is no evidence of an accidental origin of the fire, and equally no evidence that the fire was started deliberately. But the report does arrive at the legal probability of arson. Probable arson, but no evidence. The probable arson ruling gave Eamon Butterley solid ground to pursue his £3 million malicious damages case against Dublin Corporation, which he lodged within a week of the fire. The tribunal found that the main entrance, exit 2, was inadequate as an escape route. The outer doors of the main entrance were kept permanently shuttered. Steel plates were welded internally to the inside of the toilet windows. There were also vertical bars welded to the outside of the windows. And of the 5 emergency exits, exit 3 was locked with a padlock and chain. Exits 4 and 5 had a padlock and chain draped across the panic bars. The decision to keep exits locked and chained was made by Mr. Eamon Butterley.
I asked Tom Kennan, the head doorman,
if all fire exits were unlocked, and he answered me that they were, and he had men stationed at each exit in accordance with standard procedure. I personally saw that two of the exits were open.
The way chains on them!
People saw the chains on the door!
How can you say that?
We've prepared a brief statement. As representatives of the Stardust victims, we wish to make it clear that we have no problem with the legal probability of arson arrived at by Justice Keane. But we emphasize that no positive finding of arson was arrived at, and no such evidence to date has materialized. We welcome his damning indictment of Mr. Eamon Butterley, in particular with regards to Mr. Butterley's recklessly dangerous practice of keeping exit doors chained or locked. All he had to do was hire an extra three men to supervise the doors. Three? Wouldn't have cost him any more than 50 quid. That's roughly £1 for each life lost. £1. On receipt of legal advice, we have forwarded a letter to the Director of Public Prosecutions, Mr. Eamon Barnes, calling for the owners of the Stardust to be prosecuted for manslaughter on the charge of reckless negligence leading to death.
If you want to know what it's like to feel comfortable with power, space, style, award yourself the freedom of the road with the all-new SsangYong Chiron. From just €33,000, SsangYong commands the road.
At Kilmeaden, we understand patience. After all, it takes at least 10 months for our cheddar to mature. So while we're waiting, we salute the Healy's, who know their Bordeaux 2000 should be ready for drinking any year now. Good things come. Kilmeaden, the fillet of cheese.
When I was a boy, I had a bike. Me and that bike went everywhere together. I can't remember why I stopped. Life got in the way, I suppose.
Sometimes we forget life's simplest pleasures, like a bowl of crisp golden Kellogg's cornflakes, 100 years old and still number one. Rediscover the feeling.
Find out what it feels like when the job you're looking for finds you. Employers search Monster every day looking for the right candidates. But you can't be found unless you add your CV. So add your CV to Monster today and let employers find you.
Here's some great news from Aircom. We've cut the cost of calls to mobiles from your home phone by up to 17% on evenings and weekends. So get talking and texting for less with Aircom. And get more from your home phone with our range of great value packages. Free phone 1800 369
369.
Where have you been?
You should be in bed.
You have to deal with the living too, John.
Not now, Chrissy.
Talk to me. Don't clam up on me.
And say what?
I don't care anything.
You shouldn't have let them go.
Are you saying it's my fault?
No.
Then why did you say that?
I don't know. It just...
It's just what, John? All this time? Is that what you've been thinking? It's my fault?
No one gives a damn. Our girls are 6 feet under and no one gives a fuck!
Don't you blame me. Don't you dare blame me! I'm trying to hold it together, keep this family together, and you're like pricking around in your pool table down in the shed!
What the fuck do you want me to do?
Help me! Don't you ever say that to me again.
Jesus.
Why won't you look at me? You shouldn't have pretended they were still alive.
Hiya, Jimmy.
Good evening.
Carol.
How's it going?
Getting there, you know.
Kept meaning to get in to see you, but you know yourself, the longer you leave it.
All right, lads.
Messers, the pair of them. Had to get someone in. Sorry, Jimmy.
Mr. Hoy's office, please. Keegan. Christine. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, sure. I'll hold.
Can I help?
Well, if he could get back to us, this is our fourth time to call him. I realise he's a very busy man, but he's also our public representative. Right now, I think he needs all the positive publicity he can get.
Who's next?
It's Gerald.
It has been brought to our attention that a Garda report submitted to the Director of Public Prosecutions opens the possibility that the cause of the fire might not have been malicious, but a result of either faulty wiring or a defective heating system. This report does not seem to have been taken on board. We also find the DPP's decision that there are insufficient grounds to prosecute the owners of the Stardust, both contradictory and dismissive of the tribunal's findings. It's a great shock to learn that nobody is to be held accountable or responsible for the deaths of our children.
Despite the fact that
higher up
has emerged since the tribunal of inquiry in 1981, Judge O'Hanlon said he was satisfied that the fire was started maliciously. Eamon Butterley said the finding was final proof of what he had always maintained. Today, the judge approved a settlement figure of just over £580,000 in favour of Mr. Butterley.
Don't worry. It's not you I'm after. Congratulations on your compo. Out celebrating, were you? Were you, Butterley? Well, were you?
What do you want, John?
Don't you call me by my name.
Right. Let's all just calm down, huh? Why don't you come inside and have a drink and we'll talk about it.
Are you for real? What would you do if you were me? If your kids, your flesh and blood, died in that crematorium, huh?
Look, just put the chain down, please, John.
I warned you.
Look, this is going to have to stop. Oh! My teeth! Oh! Oh!
Then I'll call the guards. They died inside that door. Inside your door. My girls. My beautiful girls.
Then, no, I just
wasn't up to it today. How's Errol?
How'd it go?
Suspended sentence.
Could have been worse.
I have to pay Butterley a sum of £1,457 for damages. Now I'm giving him money. You think that's right, James?
I was telling him I think we should make the press aware of it. What?
What's the point? No one cares, Christine. We're yesterday's news.
So what are you saying? We give up? Is that what you want, Bernie? We just forget about our kids?
That's not fair.
You just want to give up the committee?
Everyone's pulling at me. Peter and the rest of the kids, I can't keep doing this. I can't.
We're fighting everyone else's cause and we're not getting anywhere.
We will.
When? When, Christine? We'd be better off doing our own thing.
There's strength in numbers.
Not for me.
What are you going to do?
Taking them to court myself. I'm sorry.
You work in a solicitor's office.
I only started last week.
Find out what you can.
I wanted him dead.
That's not the way to go, John.
Fight the good fight.
Yeah, that's right.
With what? The judge rules the fire was malicious. Butterly gets his compensation. It's them and us, Chrissy. The Golden Circle. You know what the legal blokes call the tribunal? Gold dust. Lining their pockets with our pain.
There's no point in just claiming against the Burleys. The Stardust was only insured for 250 grand. You're going to have to go against the state and Dublin Corpo as well.
The way Butterly did?
Pretty much, yeah.
Then that's what we'll do.
The thing is, they're not going to admit liability. If they can drag it through the courts, they will.
They'll use every legal loophole possible. It could take years just to get one case to court.
I don't care how long it takes, Jimmy.
Solicitors aren't cheap, Christine.
You chose the right profession then, didn't you?
You might have to pay all of their costs as well.
I'm doing this, Jimmy.
Antoinette, come on, open the door.
What's going on?
Are you drunk? Go on, don't push your luck.
John, stop it!
Antoinette!
Oh, Jesus! God. Jesus! Oh, Philip, help! Help us now!
Quick, come in, this way, Jesus. Quickly.
Oh, hurry!
Come on.
Please, hurry! Hurry, oh, God! Please, Lord.
Sorry, I'll come back.
No, you're all right, Jimmy. We're just going for a cup of tea.
So how are you doing?
Okay.
Jesus, Antoinette. You can't give up. Sometimes I want to. I want to just close my eyes and not think. Not see. But it's never going to go away. Would you have said yes if Liam asked you up?
Probably.
I drop into his ma sometimes, and I know she's glad to see me and all. But our families, our ma's, they still have us.
Look at what they've got, Jimmy. Look at us.
Liar.
All right, John. I'm chasing that up for you.
I believe it when I see it.
You'll see it.
Read the letter.
What's going on, John?
Family's destroyed, Christine. All because of greed. They died because of greed.
No. No, 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 no. Don't be stupid, John.
Nobody cares. Nobody cares, Chrissy.
Get rid of it. Get rid of it.
I can do him. I know I can. Army training.
You think that's what Mary and Martina want? What Antoinette wants? You with blood in your hands. That bastard's blood.
I don't know. Maybe.
Don't you think we've been through enough already without losing you as well? I won't have it, John. You do this, that's it. I'll turn my back on you. You will never see me or the kids again. I mean it. Get rid of it, or you needn't bother coming home.
At present, there are 245 writs by Stardust victims. Claims for liability against the state, Dublin Corporation, Eamon Butterley, Patrick Butterley, Silver Swan Limited, and Scott's Foods. Not one. Not one. More than 4 years on, and not one has come to court.
Butterley's did.
And do you think that's right, Albert?
Of course not, Ray.
We've been on to politicians and the Law Society to try and find out what's causing the delay. But we're being met with a brick wall. It's about time people knew about it. Let's show this new government. We will not be quietened. We will not go away. We will get our justice.
Fucking right. Great speech, Mr. Keegan.
Thanks.
Any word from Christine?
She might be coming over for a master a few days. Give me a chance to see a little one.
Yeah, good. And Errol?
He's okay.
Well, let him know we were asking for him, won't you?
Jesus!
Sweet and
pain again.
Yeah, help me get him into the car. Come on, it's okay. It's okay. Here we go. It's all right.
Ah, Jesus.
We are going straight to the hospital this time.
I'm gonna be all right.
We're going. Thanks, Albert.
We've removed 7 yards of his intestine, but I'm afraid the cancer is too far advanced.
How long has he got?
We're talking months rather than years. I'm sorry.
He watched his mother die of cancer. I don't want him told.
Hospitals.
Do you hate me, Dad?
Hate you?
You told me to look after him, Dad. I didn't. I didn't look after him, Dad. I didn't.
It wasn't your fault, son. It's your fault. Huh? It's your fault.
Almost 300 people initiated compensation claims against the state, but the cases still haven't come to court. Relatives' committees have urged the government to speed up the process of compensation. They'd threaten to march on the Doyle if their claims weren't dealt with. Today's announcement by the Taoiseach is the government's answer to that pressure. Dr. Fitzgerald announced that the tribunal, chaired by Mr. Justice Donald Barrington, will begin work within 3 weeks. Claimants will have the right to accept or reject its individual award recommendations. If they accept, they must call off any other court proceedings.
What the government is offering is a compensation tribunal.
Another tribunal?
This will be different. Each individual will be seen privately and assessed for the compensation.
So what's the catch? Huh?
All claims against the defendants, including the Butterleys, will have to be dropped.
But the fuckers are trying to buy us off.
They're giving us an option.
We don't want the shagging money. We want them to admit liability.
What about you, John? Christine?
It's up to each individual to decide what they want to do.
Are you going for it?
We still intend going the legal route.
So it's okay for us, but not for you, is that it? No. No, fuck this. Come on. Shouldn't have lost the head.
People need something. Solicitor reckons we get the same at this tribunal as we would if we went to court.
Never about the money. Should put some meat in those bones.
If you were awarded and accepted compensation, you had to sign away your right to establish any liability for the deaths of 48 young lives. If you didn't accept compensation, you could still take the legal route. But no one had the money to do that. That was the choice we were given.
I lost my brother, Jimmy.
My son, Liam.
My two daughters, Mary and Martina.
Who suffered nervous shock, severe mental trauma, fits of alcoholism. We assaulted the owner of the Stardust.
Our eldest girl.
Can't do this.
They refuse me. Tribunals refuse me compensation.
I
should have gone to court.
We can appeal.
Too damn right we will.
John's appeal would be refused in the Supreme Court, but he was never to find that out. Within a few months, the cancer had spread to his kidneys.
I can see them, Chrissy. Mary. Martina. They're smiling at me. Don't cry now. Stay strong for the kids.
I believe most of us regretted taking the compensation. 48 people died, and many more victims and their families' lives were shattered. 25 years later, the question of liability is still unanswered.
In memory of Michael Barrett, Richard Bennett, Carol Bissett, Jimmy Buckley, Paula Bourne, Carolyn Carey, Joan Coughlin, Jacqueline Croker, Liam Dunn, Michael Farrell, David Flood, Thelma Fraser, Michael French, Josephine Glenn, Michael Griffiths, Robert Hillock, Brian Hobbs, Eugene Hogan, Marta Kavanagh, Martina Keegan, Mary Keegan, Robert Kelly, Mary Kennedy, Mary Kenny, Margaret Kiernan, Sandra Lawless, Frances Lawler, Maureen Lawler, Paula Lewis, Eamon Luckman, George McDermott, Marcella McDermott, William McDermott, Julie McDonald, Tracy McDonald, Jared McGrath, Caroline McHugh, Donna Mann, Helen Mangan, James Miller, Susan Morgan, David Morton, Kathleen Muldoon, George O'Connor, Brendan O'Mara, John Stout, Margaret Thornton, Paul Wade. May the deceased and their families, the injured, and those who survived, never be forgotten.
Well, if you thought the Stardust disaster was history, then think again. The anniversary of the tragedy has brought with it mounting pressure for a new investigation into the tragic events of Valentine's Night 1981. This afternoon, the Taoiseach told the Doyle that the government would look at any new evidence presented. Well, tonight, Primetime can bring you the expert testimony that cast doubt over the official verdict on that deadly fire, a verdict that has caused so much heartache for the survivors and the relatives of those who died. Reid O'Reilly now reports on the flaws in the first Stardust inquiry and the case for a brand new one.
I want truth. I want to know why they died. and I want to know how they died.
It must be reinvestigated, irrespective of who it hurts.
I knew it wasn't arson, and everybody else knew it wasn't arson. In my view, the fire did not start in those chairs or seats in the back of the West Alcove.
The actual storeroom was, in a sense, a bomb waiting to be ignited.
It was the worst tragedy in the history of the state. Valentine's Night, 1981. A disco. A fire. 48 dead. 214 injured. Over 100 seriously. Most of the victims young. Whole neighborhoods plunged into trauma by the depth and scale of the loss. It's a trauma that survives in many to this day. The nation looked on as the full horror was brought to bear. It was a time for leadership and a decisive government response. The cabinet met. The Fianna Fáil ordeach was halted.
At this stage, the only thing I can do is, from the very bottom of my heart, offer sympathy, understanding, to all the families and relatives and friends concerned, and just to pray.
Within hours, the rumour had spread that arson was the cause, a rumour given substance by the manager and owner of the Stardust, Eamon Butterley.
The truth is, mate, the truth of what happened in there, I think. Now, I know certain things. The police know certain things. There are witnesses to know certain things.
Well, are you yourself, in your own mind, ruling out the question of it being malicious?
No.
Do you think it's possible?
Very possible.
The government moved quickly, announcing a tribunal of inquiry the day after the fire and confirming that reports of arson had reached the cabinet.
We have those reports, yes, certainly, but as of now, the Gardaí are still considering their inquiry as open.
As the families buried their dead, the owners of the Stardust building, the Butterley family, placed their faith in arson. They lodged a court claim, suing Dublin Corporation for malicious damages. The Stardust Tribunal held its first public sitting just 2 weeks after it was set up. It was over by that November. Reporting in 1982, Mr. Justice Ronan Keane found the cause of the fire was probably arson. Pinning the blame on an unknown arsonist meant the families and survivors had no one to successfully sue. But the law at the time meant the Butterleys, as the victims of arson, would be compensated.
The problem with a finding of arson, if it's wrong, is that the taxpayer, through the local authority, had to pay.
It was something that was on the Taoiseach's mind the day after the fire.
If there were a major claim for malicious injury against the Dublin Corporation, it's very likely the government would have to involve itself in the matter.
2 years later, the Butterleys were awarded almost £600,000 in the courts, around €1.25 million in today's terms. But victims' families and survivors had to settle for less.
They were left with no option, really, but to accept what the government proposed for them in terms of a tribunal of compensation.
In 1987, a special compensation tribunal had paid out £10.5 million among over 800 people. They had to drop all legal claims.
And I make no apologies for looking for compensation
for my seriously injured child.
The majority got less than £20,000, the equivalent of just over €33,000 today.
That was an insult to injury. Appalling. And I never knew any family, actually, from the very beginning that actually ever wanted money. People wanted justice and they wanted to be told the truth. Every family felt like that. And then it took, like, that was another 6 years of fighting, arguing your point and everything else.
We were only people there. Numbers didn't make any difference, or no count on us. We didn't get any justice, and still today, 25 years later, we still can't get justice.
The families were especially unhappy that the Butterleys won their damages claim, despite the tribunal finding that mismanagement by Eamon Butterley and his father Patrick contributed significantly to the deaths and injuries. The tribunal also found Butterley had knowingly and seriously misled Gardaí on his practice of locking exit doors. It opted to treat his evidence with the greatest reserve.
It just suddenly then people started to panic, and again we kind of got to the door, couldn't get out the door. There was a lot of people trying to get out, so I remember getting pushed back against the wall. For a minute I just stood there and I could hear the fire, I would say. It was raw, you know, it was a roar.
The tribunal found that the main entrance and another front exit were locked when the fire started. Other exits had a lock and chain draped over their push bars so as to suggest they were locked. One exit was obstructed by chairs, another by plastic skips.
I got down the end of the hallway and there was two girls standing in the hallway and they said, doors are locked. And I said, just push the bar. And they said, it can't, there's a lock on it. And I picked the lock and the chain up in my hand and it was locked. And I shook it around where some of the lads at the time used to wrap a chain around the door. It wouldn't actually be locked. If you knew just to turn it back the opposite direction, you could push bar it open and that was grand. But they used to wrap them around. But this was actually locked.
The toilet windows had also been sealed shut.
There was people on the inside of the toilet windows banging on them, actually banging and screaming. While burning, there was out.
You couldn't see the windows for fellas up trying to get them open.
I got in through a window. This girl was in the dark, I was just flashing the light anywhere at all. I just heard this voice, this direction, please help me, please, pick me. And I went to her shoes were actually melted.
From the start, the families were unhappy with the tribunal's arson finding. But in recent years, they've been re-examining the evidence with the help of this researcher, Geraldine Foy. They first took it to two fire consultants, one a former Dublin chief fire officer.
The final proposition put forward and convinced on all the evidence that that's wrong.
The families then brought their evidence to this man, one of the world's leading fire scientists, Professor Michael Delichatsis. His judgment is that the family's claim that the tribunal got it wrong needs to be taken seriously.
It based its conclusions on wrong evidence, okay? And not complete understanding of how the fire grows.
The Stardust was a big cabaret venue. It began staging discos in 1980. The tribunal concluded that the fire probably started here, beside the main bar, in empty seats in the west alcove. The alcove had tiered seating and tables rising to the back. On the night, it was screened off. According to the tribunal, someone probably slashed the seating here and set it alight, or lit newspapers on or under the seats. It believed that the fire then spread from the seats to the ceiling, and thick black smoke appeared in the alcove. The blaze then rapidly spread over the dance floor. The ceiling began to collapse. According to the tribunal, it was only then that the fire broke through the roof. This finding that the fire started in seats and spread to the roof rather than the other way around was crucial. If the opposite had been found, it might have led to a different conclusion on the cause of the fire. But it was a theory that in fact took hold very quickly.
For the moment, the police are satisfied that the fire did start in that corner over there.
The basis for this view was the first sightings of the fire by people inside.
It started where people said it started.
Which is where exactly?
In the cordoned off area. The cordoned off area.
So at that stage there was only two seats blazing
at the back, yes. A lot of smoke coming from them, but there were definitely only two seats blazing.
But the evidence of other witnesses flatly contradicts this. One was a barman, P.J. Murphy. He tried to tackle the flames. He told Primetime that he felt a monstrous heat coming from the ceiling. He gave evidence that he saw burning material coming from above. He still stands over that. And he said he was always positive that the fire started up in the ceiling. Tribunal experts tried to recreate the fire with newspaper and a match. Today's experts say the tests didn't match the Stardust reality. The results were impressive, but it took over 13 minutes for the fire to grow to this, and only with the help of more paper. And unlike the Stardust, the ceiling didn't collapse.
Now, the test clearly showed that the seats burning, the flames only went 6-8 feet high. The ceiling did not disintegrate.
None of the witnesses who were shown the footage of the tests agreed that in any way the test fire corresponds to what they saw on the night.
Just shortly after I got back onto the stage, screen went up and fireball across the ceiling, basically. And that was it. And then mayhem broke out.
In my view, the fire did not start in those chairs or seats in the back of the West alcove. I believe the fire was above the people's heads, above the suspended ceiling.
The new theory is that the fire started in the roof space and was raging above the dancers' heads long before it was spotted on the seats. The first recorded sighting inside was at 1:41 a.m., but several witnesses outside say they saw the fire earlier.
In order to accept the Tribunal's conclusions that the fire was arson and that it started in the West alcove, there's a whole series of evidence that has to be cast aside, which the Tribunal accepts as factual in their findings. There's the outside witnesses, Alan Buffini, whom the Tribunal accepts as an accurate time, sees flames going to the roof at 1:28.
Anthony Paschetti was watching the fire with Alan Buffini on the night.
I could hear the crackling noise of a roar or whatever. Where I looked out the window, I could see the roof glowing. I then went downstairs. I grew up onto the roof of our garage to get a better view. There, the flames were starting to come out through the roof at this stage. And I was joined then on the roof with my next-door neighbour, Alan Buffini. This would have been about 25 to 2 in the morning.
This evidence is supported by a photo taken by a local resident at around 1:40 a.m. Another outside witness told Primetime, "It was shortly before 1:40 when I heard the crackling noise. I went to the window and saw a fire coming from the roof of the Stardust. The flames were about the height of a door." The height of those flames at those early times left the experts perplexed as to why the tribunal chose to rely more on the timings of the people inside spotting a small fire on a seat.
We have fire coming through the roof of the building when it's still about a metre high on the seat. That doesn't seem logical.
If you'd piled all the seats in the middle of the floor, like you would do at a Halloween bonfire, the flames would not go to 36 feet.
But not everyone is impressed by that evidence. The tribunal heard from a battery of expert witnesses. One of them, this man, fire scientist David Tucker. He was engaged by Dublin Corporation. His opinion has never changed.
My view is that somebody probably did slash a seat and set fire to it.
Do you think that it's possible that people would have seen flames that they describe as the height of a door, or another witness the height of a house?
No, I don't think it can be possible. It requires the asbestos cement roof to shatter to allow flames to get out. and that will make a loud noise. And I would have thought that somebody inside the Stardust would have heard that, if that had happened.
So in order for your theory to be right, the outside witnesses' timings have to be wrong?
Yes, in that they, I don't believe, can have seen flames through the roof before about 1:45.
But the theory that the fire started in the seating faces another major hurdle. One of the few people seated just in front of the West Alcove was Linda Bishop. Shortly before 1:33, she felt a sudden change in heat. Heat that couldn't have come from a small fire spotted in seats well behind her 8 minutes later at 1:41.
It was a cold night, and like I say, went in, and probably because I never bothered to get up to dance around and just stayed cold. I was saying, like, we're freezing. And the bouncers passed by a couple of times and say, is there any chance to turn the heating on, you know? And then, like I say, at a certain stage then, I just felt suddenly warm. And I looked at my wife and said, no way, they're not turning the heating on now. It's 1:30. Actually, it was 1:33. Somebody had bought me a digital watch for Christmas. And I remember the light went on. It was 1:33. That's how I just remember that so clearly. But we were saying, they're turning the heating on now. It's nearly time to go home, you know? And that's after a few minutes then, my friend said, come on, we'll get up and dance.
Well, it didn't worry her at the time because she then went on to have a dance. So it wasn't something which concerned her at that time. I don't know whether her watch was actually accurate, but I think it's possible that a fire may actually have been burning at the back of the West Alcove at that time.
So for somebody to tell me about 15 minutes later there was a small fire up there and I was feeling warm from it doesn't make sense to me. That's not the kind of sudden warmth I felt, you know.
Professor Delichatzias believes the tribunal missed the significance of evidence of witnesses like Linda Bishop. He believes that if the fire started in the seating behind her, she would have smelled smoke.
If the fire had started this way, as I have pointed earlier, then the Linda Bishop, what's her name, would have smelled the smoke long before feeling the heat. So this is not a valid conclusion anymore.
The family's doubt about the tribunal team's finding of arson in the alcove has another source. It's the tribunal report itself. Mr. Justice Keane admitted that there was no evidence to indicate arson. As the families considered how the fire could have started in the roof space, they began to focus on a lamp projection room and a storeroom close to roof height. They now believe the tribunal seriously underestimated the significance of these rooms. In particular, they say the tribunal appears to have been unclear on what was in the storeroom and how flammable its contents were.
For that volume of combustible materials to be in a concealed place is just, you know, in many ways beyond belief.
So what was in the store? A Garda statement merely mentions roller towels, detergents, washing up liquid and toilet paper. The tribunal report adds kitchen towels, drums of cooking oil and aerosols. In fact, a detailed list of the contents of the store was provided to the tribunal by the Butterleys. It included gallons of floor wax and table polish and large quantities of other flammables. But the list was never entered into evidence. And it was sent months after the reconstruction tests were carried out. The experts believe the tribunal never appreciated just how potent a fuel load was in there.
I would be firmly of the opinion that the storeroom contents were significant and had a major impact on the development of the fire within the roof void of the Stardust building.
Were you ever given a copy of that list or made aware of its existence?
No, I was never given a copy of this list, but the items on the list are things which I would have expected to have been present in the storeroom.
They were aware that the storeroom had some combustible material, but they were clearly unaware of the extent of that. The actual storeroom was a bomb waiting to be ignited.
Primetime asked Professor Delichatzias just how flammable some of the storeroom material was.
Oh, these are very flammable. I mean, I don't want you to test it at home, but they're very flammable. Okay. They can easily ignite if they are overheated, without flame, even.
Without flame?
Yeah, if they're overheated, they can ignite without flame.
But the researchers found a more fundamental problem. They claim that the Garda layout plan the tribunal relied on was misleading. It's led them to question whether the tribunal really understood exactly where the storeroom was.
The principal map the tribunal were looking at marks the store and says over basement. Any